I pulled up to the bar in the lobby of the Lane's Hotel. The guy beside me had something he was trying to sell. He told me, he sold me stories from all through his life. But he only told me the truth when I looked into his eyes. He said, take me back home, I don't want to be alone. Take me back home. No one should have to bear this on their own. No one should have to bear this all alone. Bear this on their own. I see the same people at the same time, day after day. We nod as we pass, but that's just another way we say. Know me, show me, just tell me that I'm not alone. Give me a signal, show me a sign that all of these troubles aren't only mine. Take me back home, I don't want to be alone. Me back home. No one should have to bear this on their own. No one should have to bear this all alone. Bear this on their own. Of all the lonely people,
hello,
I'll never
everybody.
Be the loneliest one. There'll be no sequel, cause we're never coming undone. So hold me until the day that I die. Cause only, only, only the light in your eyes. Take me back home, I don't want to be alone. Take me back home, I don't want to be alone. I pulled up to the bar in the lobby of the Lane's Hotel. The guy beside me had something he was trying to sell. He told me, he sold me stories from all through his life. But he only told me the truth when I looked into his eyes. They said, take me back home, I don't want to be alone. Take me back home. No one should have to bear this on their own. No one should have to bear this all alone. Bear this on their own. Of all the lonely people, I'll never be the loneliest one. There'll be no sequel, cause we're never coming undone. Day after day, we nod as we pass, but that's just another way we say. Know me, show me, just tell me that I'm not alone. Give me a signal, show me a sign that all of these troubles aren't only mine. Take me back home, I don't want to be alone. Take me back home. bear this on their own. No one should have to bear this all alone. Bear this on their own.
Hello, everyone. Welcome. Last year, we thought it was the only year that we would be online and having an ASI that would greet everyone and try to connect. But here we are again. We're at it. So I'd like to welcome everybody who is here with us and registered, and those of you who may have joined us on live streaming through YouTube. Really happy to have you here, and we're going to get started with our opening. So I am going to ask Malcolm Schuchner, who is our president of ASI board, to welcome you and to take it from here for a few minutes before we have a welcome song with Julie Peltz-Aglash.
And so just before Malcolm begins, I will invite you, si vous souhaitez participer en français, cliquez sur l'interprétation en bas l'écran. Et choisir français si vous ne voyez pas le mot interpretation, c'est sur les trois points.
Okay, thank you, Patsy, and thank you, Wendy. And on behalf of the Board of Directors of the Atlantic Summer Institute, I would like to welcome all of you to our second online policy forum. We'd like to begin by acknowledging that ASI is based out of Mi'kma'ki, the ancestral and unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq people. This territory is covered by the Treaties of Peace and Friendship, which Mi'kmaq and Wolastoqiyik people, the Maliseet people, first signed with the British Crown in 1725. The treaties established the rules for what was to be an ongoing relationship between nations. While I'm streaming from Mi'kma'ki, we also acknowledge that we have participants today from many different regions across the territory now known as Canada. And we invite you all to take the time to learn whose territory you're living on. And I'd also invite you to add to our chat box the territory you are currently on. Not only does ASI recognize and respect the land we are settled on, we are also actively advocating for the implementation of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission's calls to action and strive to include Indigenous perspectives in all of our work. Thank you.
Thank you. And in support of both official languages and the spirit of inclusion, I'll ask Claire to provide some instructions on how to access interpretation services, the translated slides and documents and captioning as required. Claire, if you'd like to take it from here.
Thank you, Patsy. So hi, everyone. I'm just going to give a very brief instruction on how to use our live translation functions. If you would like to listen in French, you can click on the interpretation icon at the bottom of your screen and select French. During French presentations, you can do the same and click English to listen to the English side. Alors, bonjour à tous, bienvenue à l'IEA. Si vous souhaitez écouter en français, veuillez cliquer sur l'onglet Interprétation en bas de votre écran et sélectionner français. Je vous laisse un moment pour le faire maintenant. Merci bien. Thank you.
Where I'd like to start right now is in keeping with the land acknowledgement that we just heard, I'd like to introduce Julie Peltz-Aglash, our Poet Laureate of Prince Edward Island and a Mi'kmaq Knowledge Keeper for Lenui, among many other talents and recognitions included in her bio. Julie and I met last week to speak about ASI and gift her with tobacco, on which prayers have been made for the spirit of this forum. And I'd like to invite Julie to open the forum with a traditional song and prayer.
Gwe, Jalasi, Ndelewisi Julie, hello and welcome. My name is Julie. I am Mi'kmaq, and I reside in this beautiful territory known as Mi'kma'ki, and I'd like to welcome all of you in peace and friendship. I've started a smudge burning. I have some sage burning for the seven directions. We have our north, east, south, and west, up, down, and in. Now I'm going to say a quick prayer, and I really like this one, especially after all the beautiful words that I've heard so far. It's called Culture and Tradition. Culture and tradition, what are they to me? It's a way to start and let your mind be free. Culture is the root of who you are, who you pray to, who your family is, near or far, how you feel in the situations you find yourself in, how to regenerate your heart and your mind, and how to prepare for a really hard time. It is not how you dress or how you do up your hair. It is what you hear in your heart when you take the time to share. Tradition is how we do things, how things have always been done, from our ceremonies to how we all welcome the sun, from religion to prayer, to our dance, craft, and song. Our traditions we have will help keep us strong. As individuals, as families, as communities, and as a nation, our culture and traditions will pass on to our next generation. If we share it and save it in our hearts, in our minds, it will live longer than our children and grandchildren this time. And as I said, it's just a way to express sort of a reconciliation type of thing by showing that we're really not all that different, even though there is some subtle differences. But I mean, at the end of the day, when we welcome the sun, we all do it with certain joy in our hearts. So I'm going to start this beautiful gathering by thanking all of the people who have spent their time and energy and their hearts to create this wonderful event for everyone. And I'm going to drum a gathering song to celebrate that even though this is virtual, we are still gathering in a beautiful way. And thank you so much for having me, and enjoy the rest of your evening. I'm out here at Cavendish Campground. We're getting ready to do a show to entertain all of our guests out here tonight, but I didn't want to miss this. So I said, I'm going to bring my phone. I'm going to log in early, make sure I get all connected. So thank you so very much. Walalio.
Thank you, Julie. We're really privileged to have Julie with us each morning to open our day and also to close the forum on Wednesday. So we look forward to your reflections and your song and your wisdom. Thank you. At this time, I would like to introduce those who have worked so hard to bring this program to you. And I'd first like to introduce our board members. And I guess it's a little bit difficult with so many in the room to actually have everybody turn on their videos. So I do have some slides that I'll get Julie to put up. If you could share those, Julia, or Julie, I mean, just get them up so that people can see the number of individuals that have been involved. Next slide, please. Okay, so you at the first of your forum program, there are acknowledgments, and I just want to bring those to light. So Malcolm Schuchner, you've met already. Robert Cal is from St. John's in Newfoundland. Susan Hartley from PEI. Karen Clark is also from St. John's. Linda Liebenberg from Halifax. Ariane Malera from New Brunswick, from Fredericton. Kathy Leslie is also from Nova Scotia. And we have Eva Sock from Elsipoktog, and myself as a non-member in some ways, ex officio. I guess that's a better word to describe it, and also a presence and ongoing support to the board. So those are the board members who've really put their efforts behind making this happen year after year. We also have Program Planning Committee, which has had two phases. One is the actual design of the program, and then a lot of people stay on and continue working for a full 6 months in trying to bring this to life. So again, Malcolm is chairing that, but we have Barbara Broom from Indigenous Services Canada, Brandon Hay from the Mental Health Commission, David French from Away Home Canada, Diane Oikel from the National Collaborating Center for Determinants of Health, Greg Arsenault from Holland College, Wendy Craiglin-Gauthier, who has been also working with us on our team and helping us to keep this sound educationally as an online experience, Linda Liebenberg, Mary Jane McKittrick from Away Home Canada, and we also have Megan Adams from Health PEI, Trevor Hancock from Victoria, and you can see on the list when you look at the acknowledgements that we have had some other folks from Department of Education in New Brunswick, Andrew Culberson, Matthew McNally from Special Olympics PEI, and Doug Curry from Holland College. So it's a very comprehensive and regional and now becoming a very national planning committee. So we're very excited and very strengthened by their work and their contribution. And lastly, we could not be doing this if it wasn't for the team that's been pulled together. I'm myself as coordinator, and we have two people who are with Canada Summer Jobs. That's been possible for them to work with us again this year. Claire Chilton and Chantel Peng, who has coordinated the Youth Leadership Program. Claire, who I'm sure you've met many different ways, as communications, public relations, helping with registration, etc. Julia Abundo was with us last year with Canada Summer Jobs, and she's come back this year to really give some support and energy to this team. And Wendy Craiglin-Gauthier as well. Miso Sato has been doing a lot behind the scenes and doing some surveys and keeping us organized. So there's quite a crew that have really put their shoulders to the wheel. And lastly is Anne Gotts. Sorry about that, Anne, who is again with us this year. It was really fun because we had all of them saying, can we come back this year? It was a good time last year. We really enjoyed it and we'd like to work with you. Anne is an international intern who's just graduated and going on for her master's in Denmark. And she's with us here tonight as well. So that is really the crew that has put it together. And anyone who might be interested after spending this next 2 days with us and wants to be involved is certainly welcome. We are a growing team and really need the energy and renewal constantly to keep this going. So I will just let you know that there's room for anybody who would like to be involved. So Wendy, I'm going to get you just to talk a little bit about the technology, and I'm not exactly sure what you have to say, but I'm sure it'll be helpful.
Sure thing. My role is to hopefully iron out some of the technical details with Zoom. So you'll notice that as you come in, your mic is active. We decided to keep it active and relying on good faith that you will observe the proper etiquettes in Zoom. If you are not speaking, we ask that you do keep your mic muted. If you do find that you have bandwidth issues, keeping your video off as well makes a huge difference. Down at the bottom of the Zoom screen, you'll notice that there is the opportunity to chat. And if you haven't found that, it's just the it looks like a little icon, like a chat bubble. And that will allow you to engage in comments, reflection as the speakers are presenting their information throughout the sessions. Depending on the sessions throughout this evening and the rest of our days together, your presenter may ask you to hold questions to the end, or they may ask you to have ongoing conversation as the presentation unfolds. So your presenters will lead you through how they would like to use the microphone and the chat. And Karen, great. You'll notice that some of us will turn off your mics on you if you do end up with your microphones on by accident. We do have our French language translation that is also available under the translation or the three dots. And you'll notice that we have the auto transcription that is running at the bottom of the screen to help increase our accessibility. Unfortunately, auto transcription is not perfect. And if I speak too fast or do not articulate my words well enough, it has difficulty finding those words. And as well, the transcription is English only. If you do have a question or a comment, we ask that you raise your hand, and you can find that in the reactions icon on the Zoom screen, and you'll notice that there's a raise hand feature there. You can also use some of the other emotions in your reactions. If you like what you're hearing, I just put my heart on mine because I'm so happy to be here. So I will also send private chats to folks if you have any difficulties. If you double click on my name in the participant window, you can send a private message to me as well. And Karen, thank you. That's actually a good point. If you do get bumped out and you do come back in, you'll notice that your mic becomes active again. So it's just something to keep an eye on. But other than that, I welcome you all to our Zoom platform and looking forward to meeting you in this virtual space over the next two days.
So Wendy, I know that we've talked quite a bit about actually people on the Q&A using the HUVA feature where it says ask a question over on the right-hand side. And that way it keeps the questions inside HUVA so that we can go back and we can have speakers actually respond at a later date if they don't happen to be able to do that now. So yeah, you're nodding. Good. I'm glad because I know so if you have questions as this is going on, and it's not just about chat, but it really is a question for the speakers or anything that's come up, if you can use the blue bar that you see that says ask a question, that would be great. And we will be able to capture it that way.
And so what's great about those questions is that you can continue those questions and reflections after the session as well, where in Zoom it would be locked into the recording.
That's right. And it's gone. So we want to keep it going. Just so that you also know is that by registering for this forum, you actually are entitled to come in at any time. You can ask questions, you can carry on the dialogue, and you can view the recorded sessions that you might have missed. I know there are a lot of concurrent sessions and people are saying, well, which one am I going to be able to take and take in? And you can come back in for the next 3 months. We have the license and we can hold it open. So that does give you privileges that you mightn't have otherwise. So having said all that, I would really like now to introduce the supporters and sponsors as they provide welcoming remarks. And we have heard from our premier, Dennis King. If you want to put those up, that would be great. So Dennis The Premier couldn't be here tonight, but he sent greetings saying, "It's my pleasure on behalf of the province of Prince Edward Island to welcome you to the Atlantic Summer Institute's Policy Forum, The Great Reconnect. Of course, we wish you could all be with us in person, enjoying our beautiful island, our outstanding beaches, and world-class cuisine. We hope that the 2022 Atlantic Summer Institute will return to an in-person event. A lot of experience in this virtual room, and by working together, I know we will find ways we can be more effective and better to serve Islanders and all Canadians. Hope you enjoy the forum, and I look forward to hearing about the amazing work you all do over the coming days. Stay safe and keep up your good work." So we're glad to hear from him. We wish he could be here, but he can't be everywhere. So we appreciate the time it's taken to put together that message and glad to have it. So next we have a message from the mayor of Charlottetown, and City of Charlottetown has been a great supporter as well. And they're the actually sponsor of our keynote. So this is Mayor Philip Brown and bringing greetings from the City of Charlottetown.
Good evening, distinguished guests and delegates. I would like to first acknowledge that I'm speaking to you from unceded Mi'kmaq territory, and I would like to pay my respects to the Indigenous peoples of Prince Edward Island, past, present, and future. As mayor of the City of Charlottetown, birthplace of Confederation, it is my pleasure to be here virtually to welcome you to the opening ceremonies of the Atlantic Summer Institute on Healthy and Safe Communities 2021 Policy Forum. The theme this year is The Great Reconnect, Building Personal, Community, and Societal Resilience for Our Post-COVID-19 World. This theme of connecting and the discussion that will follow could not be more timely. The Atlantic region finds itself at a crossroads on critical issues as we begin to imagine and work towards a post-pandemic world. With municipalities across the Atlantic region facing unique challenges, this is the best possible time to continue discussions about what a healthy and safe community looks like and what we can all do to make it better. As the past 17 months has made clear, the pandemic has impacted everything on a global, national, local, and personal level. It sometimes seems that the solutions to these broader issues are beyond the horizon of our influence. This is far from true. There are always solutions within our reach, and they begin with all of us here today. The theme of this forum strikes at the heart of the shared responsibility we have to ourselves and each other. As we reconnect, the movement towards a healthier and safer community begins with personal decisions and lifestyle changes and spreads outward, resulting in effective social change. All of us look forward to learning from the national and regional experts at this policy forum about the links between mental health, the importance of connection, and resilience in our society, and how policy can support these needed changes. Here in Charlottetown, birthplace of Confederation, we recognize the challenges we face and the solutions. More affordable housing, an ever-expanding active transportation work, data collection, and sustainable practices. All of this has a role to play in recovery and resilience. I'm pleased to hear that the ASI offers a youth leadership program with 20 qualified youth leaders from the Atlantic region this year. Their perspectives on the critical issues discussed in this forum are vital, and all of us look forward to hearing your contributions. This evening, we are lucky to have Dr. Teresa Tam, Canada's Chief Public Health Officer, here with us to establish the context for the discussion. Dr. Tam's leadership throughout this difficult period and still today has been invaluable, and we are very much looking forward to hearing her perspective on these issues. Following this presentation, Paul Bourne from the Tamarack Institute will provide the keynote address. Mr. Bourne is a global leader and an award-winning author on issues that face communities. He has a breadth of expertise in creating and sustaining vibrant communities. I want to personally extend a sincere thank you to Dr. Teresa Tam, Paul Bourne, Patsy Beatty Huggin, the organizing committee, and all the partners involved in this forum. Thank you for creating an opportunity to learn about how to create healthier and safer communities. Be smart, stay apart, and stay safe. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup.
Very good. Strong messages indeed. And he's a very big advocate of the work of the Summer Institute, and we really appreciate the support. Our next speaker has been a sponsor. Their program has been a sponsor for the last 2 years now to really foster relationships between Quebec and English Canada and to share some of the expertise of Quebec with the rest of Canada. And Maude André Lefebvre, head of the Quebec office of the that department in the Atlantic provinces, is going to speak now. Thank you.
Bonjour à tous. C'est un grand plaisir pour moi d'être avec vous aujourd'hui afin de lancer ce forum organisé par l'Atlantic Summer Institute et ayant pour thème la résilience personnelle, communautaire et sociétale dans un monde post-COVID-19. Cette édition est la deuxième réalisée avec le soutien du secrétariat du Québec aux relations canadiennes qui contribue à l'événement par l'entremise du programme d'appui aux relations canadiennes. Ce programme a justement été créé dans l'idée de favoriser le dialogue et l'échange d'expertise entre les sociétés civiles du Québec ainsi que des autres provinces et territoires. Le forum organisé par la CIE s'inscrit parfaitement dans la logique de ce programme en invitant des experts québécois et canadiens pour échanger sur la question importante de la santé mentale des jeunes, surtout dans un contexte pandémique. La collaboration avec le Québec est au cœur du forum et le caractère entièrement bilingue de l'événement l'ouvre à un public francophone du Québec et des autres provinces et territoires. Aussi, il arrive à un moment extrêmement opportun alors que les souvenirs du sommet sur le rapprochement des francophonies canadiennes sont encore vifs, et que l'élan de solidarité francophone à travers le Canada est fort. Dans le contexte du renouvellement de la politique du Québec en matière de francophonie canadienne, le forum représente une belle occasion d'insister sur l'importance de préserver la culture, la langue et l'identité francophone partout au pays. Évidemment, la COVID-19 a affecté l'ensemble de la population canadienne, tant au niveau de la santé physique que de la santé mentale. Dans ce domaine, le réseau de la santé québécois a mis en citoyens et les citoyennes. Dans le cadre de ce forum, vous aurez l'occasion d'en apprendre davantage sur ces mesures grâce à la participation de 5 experts québécois, Mme Renée Ouimet, Édith Saint-Hilaire, Nicole Bernier, la Dr Mélissa Généreux et M. Olivier Bellefleur. La présence d'experts québécois à ce forum contribue au déploiement de liens entre nos provinces et à l'instar du mandat du Bureau du Québec dans les provinces atlantiques permet de pousser plus loin cette relation entre les provinces atlantiques et le Québec. Nous ne pouvons encore mesurer l'ensemble des impacts de la COVID-19 sur nos vies, notamment sur la santé mentale des jeunes. Il est toutefois bénéfique que des experts issus de plusieurs provinces et territoires collaborent afin de faire l'état des lieux et de présenter des solutions innovantes. Je souhaite à tous les participants des échanges stimulants et constructifs et que de nouvelles collaborations émergent à l'issue de ce forum. Évidemment, le SQRC et les bureaux du Québec au Canada sont là pour vous accompagner dans la poursuite de vos projets de mise en réseau. Le renforcement de nos liens dans la Fédération passe non seulement par des relations intergouvernementales dynamiques et constructives, mais également par la mobilisation et l'échange avec la société civile, les scientifiques, les chercheurs, les jeunes et les entrepreneurs. Sur ce, je vous souhaite un excellent forum à tous.
Okay, we want to recognize the contribution, and this is our first opportunity. I should have really given a heads up. It's our first opportunity to have a speaker that is addressing us in French, And I'm hoping everyone had an opportunity now to know how to turn on the simultaneous translation or interpretation services so that you were able to capture what the speaker had to say. So we wanted to thank our sponsors. We have one last one who is our title sponsor for our youth program, and that's TD Bank. And they have been with us now for at least the last 5 years. And again, this year they are with us. So this big thanks to TD for their support and their acknowledgement. So if you could turn on their video, that would be great.
During these challenging times, we believe it's essential to continue working with community organizations that help bring people together, even when we're apart. And that's why we're supporting 60 music and cultural festivals in a safe way across Canada this summer through the TD Ready commitment.
Okay, short and sweet. We have one more slide, I believe, that really shows all the different sponsors that we have and partners. Again, we can't do it without them. Really appreciate them and want to acknowledge their contribution. So Julia, if you can show that last slide, and then we'll move on to another presentation. It'd be great. Thank you. And we'll have this is available in your program as well, so you can see the list of sponsors. We have community partners with the Community Foundation and United Way, TD, you've heard from, Holland College. MediV is a gold sponsor this year, Bell Let's Talk, and we have a number of organizing partners, which you can see in more detail in the program. Want to thank all of you very much for all your support. And then I will now want to introduce Malcolm Schuchner again. And before I do that, I know I'd be remiss, at least from Claire's point of view, if I didn't ask you all to take this opportunity while you're here and attending the forum to use social media to let people know what we're doing here and to get out some messages, strong messages, to a wider population that can't get here. So I want to introduce again Malcolm, and he's going to give you a little bit of background on what ASI has been doing through the winter months. And I will turn off my video and we'll turn on some slides for Malcolm.
Thank you, Patsy. Hello again, everyone. I'd like to give you some highlights of a new program we started this past spring. Online presentations, which were inspired by the success of our first virtual forum last summer. And because we had all the presentations recorded, we thought we'd like to extend the opportunity for others to engage with the workshop presenters and further the conversation into the spring of 2021 about some of the important issues facing us. So we put together a series of five. Julia, you can move to the next slide. Five workshops. And the first one provided an overview by Linda Lieberman. The second one, a societal level perspective. A third, an individual level. The fourth, a community level. And the fifth one was an ASI policy brief review and workshop, which you're going to be hearing more about in the coming days. Next slide. We first heard from Linda Liebenberg, who's an independent researcher and evaluator. It was about promoting and sustaining child and adolescent mental health, the role of community resilience and how we foster it. And here's one quote from that workshop. Increasingly, research is demonstrating the critical importance of context in child and youth outcomes, where changes in environment account for greater amounts of psychosocial outcomes than changes in individuals themselves. Consequently, if we want to ensure better mental health and societal outcomes for our children, we need to expand our attention from person and family-focused interventions to community-focused interventions. Community matters, bottom line. The next slide, we then heard from Dr. Gaynor Watson Creed, who was our 2019 keynote speaker with our last face-to-face event. Dr. Watson Creed is Assistant Dean Serving Engaging Society for Dalhousie University's Faculty of Medicine. And prior to that, she was the Deputy Chief Medical Officer of Health for Nova Scotia. And she talked about welcoming communities, spaces and places for peace and well-being. She talked about how that can be done both at the individual level and at the policy level. And one of the images that remains in my mind from her presentation is talking about a bench in a public place where for a while people thought that certain people weren't allowed to sit there. And after some discussion and conversation and some intervention, it was determined that a bench in a public place is for everyone. So it was a very interesting and provocative talk by Dr. Watson Creed. By the way, native of PEI, she was glad to come to the forum and return home for the event. The next slide. This was very interesting, talking about the individual level. Doris Payer, who is a knowledge broker at the Canadian Center on Substance Abuse and Addiction. And she spoke about the Brain Builders Lab, which she describes as the first steps in aligning policy practice and public perception with the science of ACEs. And ACEs means adverse childhood experiences. The interesting thing about this, what's hiding behind this language is a very engaging workshop based on brain science and how infant brains develop, the generation of the neurons and the connections in the brain, and the degree to which stimulation of infants from the very beginning can really help to grow their brains and grow their brain's capacity, which has lifelong positive impacts. And she also spoke about ways that things that can be done by people working with children who have had adverse experiences or are living in disadvantaged or impoverished environments, things that can be done to mitigate the external challenges and continue to provide support to the infant and young child to develop their brains to their maximum capacity. Very interesting. You'll hear more about that. This is one of our Atlantic Showcase projects, which you'll hear about very shortly. The next slide, we talked about the community level, and this was one of our colleagues from Quebec, Renee Ouimet, who spoke about how to create, develop, and strengthen mental health for all year round, and how to move the focus from mental illness to mental health. And this is one of the challenges that we all find is when we talk about mental health, we are talking about upstream promotion of mental health, creating the positive conditions for everyone to thrive, especially our children and youth, and what we can do at the community level to create those positive conditions. It was a very interesting and stimulating contribution from our colleagues in Quebec. And then the fifth workshop was on the ASI policy brief, which is a work in progress. And you're gonna be hearing more about that on Wednesday. In fact, you'll have an opportunity to participate in shaping that policy brief, and you'll hear more about what's going to happen to it when it's ready. And this work has been led by David French and Mary Jane McKitterick from Away Home Canada, a national organization working on youth homelessness. And we've been very fortunate to have David and Mary Jane's leadership and commitment to wrangle a work group of more than 20 people, and I use the verb wrangle specifically, to get 20 people from across the country, from almost every province, to participate in shaping key elements of policies that we believe are needed to promote upstream investment for child and youth mental health. So the last of these online workshops was a chance for people to come together and actually discuss the content and actually shape the direction the policy brief is going. So those were our five online workshops. All participants all said that they were very pleased and excited to participate in them. And we want to thank the Mental Health Commission of Canada for providing financial support to help enable these workshops to happen. And the board of directors of Atlantic Summer Institute will be assessing the results of this series and deciding going forward into 2022 if and whether and how we might launch a series of online workshops in the coming year based on the kinds of presentations that we're going to be hearing in the next couple of days. So those were the highlights, and we were very happy about them, and some of you may have participated in them. So I think I'm finished with that part now, and I guess it's time for me to introduce Claire Chilton again, who is going to talk to you and show you the Atlantic Community Showcase. Over to you, Claire.
Thank you, Malcolm. Just give me 1 minute here. Okay, so we are extremely excited to share our Atlantic Canadian Showcase with you this year. You will see in a couple minutes, 6 videos from organizations and programs across the Atlantic provinces that are outstanding examples of upstream work in mental health in communities. You can find these videos under the exhibit tab in Whova, and I would encourage all of you to check out the awesome showcases in more detail over the coming days. On the exhibit page, you'll find contact information, website links, and more for all of these showcases. So you can get in touch with the contacts for these showcases if you have any questions or if you would like to learn more about the programs. So first, we are going to begin. And Chantal will pull up the video for Health Messengers, Empowering People with Intellectual Disabilities to Advocate for Inclusive Wellness. This is a video that is prepared by Special Olympics PEI Healthy Communities Project. And our lovely contact for this is Matthew McNally.
Access to wellness should not be exclusive. Our athletes add diversity, add challenges, and add spirit to their lives. We fight for all athletes. To
add movement.
That each Islander knows how to
add healthy food.
That Islanders with intellectual disabilities can
add fun, add wellness.
Special Olympics PEI works to ensure that Islanders with intellectual disabilities have access to the same health services and can add wellness to their lives.
Hi, my name is Heidi Mellon. I'm a Special Olympic athlete from Prince Edward Island. I want to talk about plain language, but before I do that, I'm going to say this. I find it a privilege and a right to speak up for myself and be a voice for those that cannot speak up for themselves. Plain language is important for people with intellectual disabilities because they need to have information in a plain language so they can understand the information. For an example, like when you go to the dentist, it's good to be to make that patient or client comfortable so that they can understand the information in plain language. And what I mean by comfortable is maybe asking them, what kind of sports do you play, or what have you been up to today, or what's going on out in the community. Another one is that procedures, like for an example, when you go to the doctor to get a physical exam done, or the dentist for teeth cleaning or filling, you should explain the information, put the information in plain language so that he or she can understand the information and put it in step by step as you're doing the procedure, and so that they will understand and feel more comfortable in the setting and in the environment that they're in. Thank you.
Thank you, Chantal, and everyone at Special Olympics PEI for putting that together. Next, we are going to watch Community Youth Networks of Newfoundland and Labrador, Who We Are, What Do We Do? This was prepared by the YMCA and Youth 2000 Center, and it was brought to us by Terry Lynn Berry.
The CYNs of Newfoundland and Labrador, a place for our youth to learn and grow together. We are inclusive and diverse, offering a safe haven for our province's youth ages 5 to 29 years old. We operate in different capacities across the province, but all have the same end target and goals: to provide meaningful and everlasting learning experiences and opportunities to our youth, providing resources and opportunities for social recreation, academics, sharing of skills and knowledge, intergenerational growth, preparing youth for adulthood, volunteerism, and engagement with our community partners, and more. This past year has been a challenge for the youth's participants' families, our staff, and volunteers. COVID-19 has presented a multitude of challenges, roadblocks, and barriers to our programming, but the CYNs of Newfoundland and Labrador have remained committed to our values and mission statements, continuing to build on youth relationships, leadership skills, and engagement with a strong focus on physical and mental well-being. We have had to pivot like the rest of the world. We have had to cancel events and activities. We have lost connections at times with the participants and families, but through it all, we have grown, we have reconnected, and we've changed how we do things. In this video slideshow, we are focusing on the Youth 2000 Center in Grand Falls, Windsor, that operates in partnership with the Exploits Valley YMCA. We will show how, in a COVID-19 world, we, along with the CYNs of Newfoundland and Labrador, have reconnected with ourselves, others, and our communities, finding innovative ways to do the things we always did and will continue to do in our post-pandemic world, always instilling a positive outcome in our youth, our future. When the pandemic first started, the youth started to fear what was happening to the world they lived in. To help change their thinking into positivity and encouraging ways to remain strong and resilient, youth started to focus on ways they can make the world we live in a better place to be. Through virtual means, we started to learn about recycling and started cleaning up our community. Through youth leadership, we started a recycling club and have met in person and had many presentations, with more to come in the near future.
Cleaning up our environment is important to me because we all have a part to play in making the world clean and a safe place to live.
With mental wellness and health being a strong concern through COVID-19, we strengthened and grew on our partnership with the Canadian Mental Health Association of Newfoundland and Labrador, the central office.
We play online trivia. I love playing in person and joining on Zoom when it was my turn to stay home and play.
We shared resources such as community connections like the Stable Way and worked together, ensuring that we had continued to foster community engagement through a variety of activities, including fundraising and giving back to the community that has given so much to us. We started a new program. Yes, a new program in the midst of a pandemic. Why, you ask? Because the youth asked. The youth wanted to connect. The youth wanted to talk about what mattered to them. Along came Mondays Matter, a program started virtually for the youth to chat, socialize, and most importantly, reconnect. One thing we have all experienced so strongly through this pandemic is that our youth are resilient. We remain inclusive and diverse through resiliency and have not given up during the closures and changes to programming during the pandemic. Youth have demonstrated resiliency through encouragement to continue with social rec activities, inclusion, and academics, even when things were tough, with the outcomes and platforms unknown. Through presentations with community partners, both in person and virtually, we instilled a sense of belonging and normalcy in a world which was certainly anything but the norm.
Friends. We missed our friends in person, but love changing out. We missed our friends in person, but loved hanging out in our virtual chat rooms.
We offered cooking classes, art classes, paint nights, sewing kits, yoga, and more, all with Zoom and Google Meets. We helped the kids with homework one-on-one when it was safe, and allowable to do so based on the health measures in place. We worked one-on-one over Zoom and Google Meets and had telephone calls with the youth struggling to adapt to the new platform of online learning and schooling at home. We maintained our connection with Kids Eat Smart as well, ensuring the youth had healthy snacks at home. We started planting produce at home, knowing that there would be a time we would get together and plant it in our community garden. When the restrictions of the pandemic started to lift this summer, we were excited to give the kids some great learning experiences in the garden, with a live beehive to view and learn about through interactive in-person sessions with the beekeeper and his team. We did not let COVID-19 bring us down. We engaged with the community and continued to support local. We spent countless hours outside doing various activities and having tons of fun. We started a hybrid platform when the pandemic's health measures allowed us to meet in smaller groups. We had bubbled groups with us at the center with dozens more joining from the safety of their homes. With continued support of our government and surrounding communities, the CYNs of Newfoundland and Labrador look forward to our new normal and how to keep going forward in this world as we navigate our way in a post-COVID-19 world as we reconnect.
Great. Thank you, Chantel, and thank you, Terry Lynn. Next up, we have The Way Forward, Understanding Healthy Masculinity. This is brought to us by the Eskazoni Mental Health Services and Linda Liebenberg.
The Way Forward is implemented by Eskazoni Mental Health Services. In our community of Eskazoni, Unamagi, on the shores of Bedore Lakes.
The project has been adapted from Morris Green Skies Group Program and the Way Forward Program implemented in Saskatchewan by the Saskatchewan Prevention Institute.
The adaptation for our program has its roots in two research projects. The first is Spaces and Places, a participatory action research program that explored the factors that facilitate culture engagement of young people in the community.
Second was Networks for Change, a participatory action research project and focused on sexual and gender-based violence and how it affects young people in the community, girls and women in particular.
Findings from both studies highlighted the important role of connection to culture and healthy relationships in supporting positive outcomes for young people. Importantly, the studies also brought to the light the need for young men to provide for younger boys with healthy role models in supporting healthy outcomes. Finally, Networks for Change identified the value of the seven sacred teachings in shaping healthy relationships.
Additionally, Eskazoni Mental Health Services identified the need to find more effective ways of connecting with young men in early adulthood.
The various information has resulted in a way forward understanding healthy masculinity, a training program for young men aged 20 to 33 years old.
The goal of the program is to support healthy help-seeking behavior, healthy relationships, and ensure positive role models and mentors for younger boys in the community.
Drawing on our knowledge from the Spaces and Places study, as well as Networks for Change, we have adapted the original program for school-aged youth, transformed into a training for young men, who then act as mentors for younger boys in the community.
The core focus of the program is instilling a sense of healthy masculinity in the young men's training as mentors, a sense that they can pass on to the young boys they mentor.
To achieve this, the program has 9 core modules focusing on related topics.
Threaded throughout the modules is an underlying focus on fostering mental health, as well as healthy relationships.
The entire program is embedded within the medicine wheel, recognizing that true health depends on the integration of mental, emotional, spiritual, and physical health.
Related to the medicine wheel are the 7 sacred teachings, many of which have been linked to each module.
Connect with a member of our team to discuss the program in more detail. We are
Angela Bernard,
Linda Liebenberg, and
Hugh Paul.
Thank you to Angelo, Hugh, and Linda for that. Next up, we have Planet Youth New Brunswick, which is from Public Health New Brunswick, and Julie McCackern.
Hi, I'm Julie McCackern, a senior advisor with Public Health New Brunswick. I'm part of a team working on adapting and preparing Planet Youth for implementation in New Brunswick. Listen in for the next few minutes to learn more about this upstream approach. Planet Youth has been implemented in well over 30 countries, with nearby locations including Lanark County, Ontario, and just across the border in Vermont. And if you're wondering what exactly Planet Youth is, it is a model or method based on the evidence-informed Icelandic prevention model focused on youth substance use prevention. New Brunswick will be implementing Planet Youth as a pilot project, starting out small with 4 pilot sites. We'll be working with early innovators so that we can learn as much as we can from the pilot. This will best inform consideration of scaling up in the future. So why this model? Planet Youth has shown good success in Iceland, providing a model for action in New Brunswick. Think of the issues around alcohol, tobacco, cannabis, and nicotine vaping. These tend to be wicked population health problems. They are complex and heavily influenced by structural and commercial determinants. These issues require policy action from a health, equity, and social justice perspective. But one model alone will not solve these complex issues. Embedding Planet Youth within a broader approach to upstream prevention that emphasizes policy action will strengthen the effect. Our approach to upstream prevention aims to advance a structuralist approach grounded by the WHO's conceptual framework for action on the determinants of health equity, as shown here. Action on the determinants of health is difficult to achieve, but this only means that we need to try harder, not to devolve towards lifestyle drift. Our goal is for Planet Youth to contribute to this. One small aspect of achieving this requires being clear on what level and type of strategic impact we can expect our actions to have, from individualized interventions within the broader field of health to applying health promotion processes to achieve upstream population health goals. Action upstream is the least common. While Planet Youth as a model is adaptable to local contexts, the project presents a unique opportunity to also look closely at the health promotion policy infrastructure and ideology and systems that support this within the Icelandic context. From social welfare policy to concerted focus on strong alcohol policy, there's ample opportunity to explore how this approach can be used to help create critical policy windows. The aspects of Planet Youth that carry over from the Icelandic prevention model relate to a method for supporting community collective action on factors that influence youth substance use at a community and broader level. In a nutshell, the model is a solutions-focused, data-informed approach to identifying and progressing solutions that will positively impact youth substance use. Planet Youth follows 3 pillars of success: evidence-based practice, using a community-based approach, and creating and maintaining a dialogue among research, policy, and practice. This work will apply health promotion to target substance use in 2 ways. Directly, through addressing the commercial determinants of health, including retail environments and marketization, and indirectly, by focusing on the broader determinants of health, their quality and distribution. We are still in the early stages of planning. We're preparing for the first round of Planet Youth data collection to begin in 2022, which will set the course for action. We encourage you to reach out if you are interested and would like to learn more, or would like to stay connected about this work.
Thank you very much. So our next video is Brain Builders Lab, the Atlantic Canadian Experience. And this is brought to us by Heather Chase from the Horizon Health Network. Thank you, Heather.
Good morning. My name is Heather Chase, and I'm one of your team members from the Atlantic Canada Brain Builders Lab. I'm speaking to you today from Black's Harbour, New Brunswick, the unceded territory of the Pascatomagadi peoples. And I'm so excited to be able to be here today to provide you with a brief introduction of the work that the Atlantic Brain Builders Lab has been doing since 2019. The Brain Builders work got started by a recognition from the Canadian Centre on Substance Use and Addiction, and their recognition of how adverse childhood experiences, or ACEs, can have an impact on many life outcomes and health outcomes, including addiction and mental health. They brought together a network of approximately 65 participants from across Canada, and they brought us to Ottawa for a two-day kickoff event where we were able to work together to build a plan that we could then use to spread and embed the science of ACEs across the country. We were also very fortunate at that time to have a wonderful selection of experts and panelists there to help us stimulate our thought and give us some best practice information around what is happening in other parts of the country. And I do want to just make a note that positive childhood experiences also have a very important role to play as we build resiliency. And that fits in so nicely with the theme of the Atlantic Summer Institute this year. And I think that it's more important now than ever that we focus on building our connections and resiliency as we come back out of COVID. So since 2019, your team of 10 Atlantic Canada Brain Builders have been meeting periodically to definitely look at our Atlantic Canada framework and what it is that we're doing, but we've also been working independently on our own plans and projects. So we have teams, team members from New Brunswick, PEI, Nova Scotia, and Newfoundland, and we all came to the Brain Builders Lab with specific projects in mind. But when we got to Ottawa, it was identified that because of the Atlantic Canada region, how we work, and there's quite a bit of crossover between our nonprofits and governments and families, that it maybe made sense that we all work together. So since then, we have been working on spreading and embedding the science of ACEs through the Brain Story Certification, which is a wonderful free online course that anyone can take. I can do it, you can do it, as the first step in actually helping people understand how our childhood experiences impact our life outcomes. So I really want to invite you to go to our project page so that you can watch the videos that we've done and get to know your team members in your home provinces, and also hear a little bit about how each province is using the Brain Story certification from the Brain Builders Lab to help everyone understand the impacts that these early experiences have. Thank you so much.
And thank you, Heather, for sharing that with us. So last but certainly not least, we have quality improvement in First Nations childcare. This was brought by the North Shore Mi'kmaq District Council and Helen Bernard Ward.
Hi, my name is Helen Bernard Ward. I work for an organization called North Shore Mi'kmaq District Council. We currently serve seven of our Mi'kmaq communities here in New Brunswick. And today I'm going to talk to a little bit about a project that we've been doing with those communities called Quality Improvement for First Nations Childcare. And I think it really ties well to this year's theme at the ASI, which is mental wellness. What we're hearing back from our communities is that they feel supported. They feel they have something now structured to help them support the children in their centers, and that they're really happy that the culture is included throughout the process. So this is a little bit about what the AQI assessment for quality improvement is, if you would like to read over this real quickly. For us, when we reviewed our First Nation Head Start standard and guidelines, we felt that the AQI was really paralleled with the outcomes that we were looking at. They really believe that every child deserves quality care regardless of their social economic situation, and that the standards and the expectations of quality are the same for every community and every child care center. So that's what really guided us to want to bring this type of assessment tool to our communities. So these are two of the few guidelines that they have, and the guidelines are on a 5-point rating scale. So we start with the does not meet expectation, meets expectation, exceeds expectation. So this is what it would look like. Here's the domain that we would be assessing. So for the staff, they understand the intent they have pedagogy, reflective questions, sensory experiences. And then we really support them in wanting to learn how to meet that expectation and eventually exceed that expectation. So the three areas of requirements, these three areas serve as a planning tool for early childhood educators and have been utilized as a resource to support quality in NAT's program, environment, and interaction. That is really the base of this assessment. So planning and observation is, you can take a few minutes just to read that. So basically what we're doing is we're really getting our staff to always plan for continuous learning opportunities and really take into account the child development piece, because some of our centers are multi-age. So when I say multi-age, I mean that a center could have 2 and 3, sometimes a four-year-olds in the same group. So we really want our staff to understand that the child development piece, there's, you know, a two-year-old's development is different than a four-year-old's development, and we really have to cater and plan to those learning experiences and those child development pieces. So we want to also do that, but we also want to scaffold their learning at the same time. So the learning environment, we really encourage our staff to, when planning the learning experiences, that they create these learning environments within their centers for them. So making sure that, you know, we know that children lead in the learning. So for example, if a child is very interested in learning about a particular kind of plant or learning about the outdoors, then we're really trying to incorporate that into our learning environment through books, through displays, through dramatic play, through language and literacy, even through cognitive and manipulative things. So building things, maybe trying to build a little forest with the Lego blocks. So things like that. And then the interactions. Interactions are key. In my previous role as a teacher, teaching grade 1 and 2 and a former principal, I really felt that in order to teach children, you have relationships were number one. You really had to establish a relationship with the child. And so we're really emphasizing positive interactions with children, and also having our staff understand that this has to be modeled and mentored. So those interactions also should be positive amongst each other and amongst adults coming into the building as well. So that is a very quick overview of the AQI and how it's supporting our communities. And if you have any questions, I left my email at the end so that you could also email me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Helen. And thank you as well to Chantal for sharing all of those videos. I just want to go back and say again that if you want to watch the videos back over again, or if you want any more information about any of the showcases, you can find that under the exhibit tab in Hoover. If you have any questions about how to get there, feel free to email me and ask, but it would be definitely worth everyone's while to get more information on those programs, because how awesome are they? All right, back to you, Patsy.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. I was just thinking about all the creativity that went into those videos and how creative the programs are themselves, covering a wide range from infants to early years through to youth. So I think that exhibit page is really a wealth of connections and knowledge and really encourage everybody to go. Our next speaker was to be Dr. Tam. And as many of you know, we ran into a hitch, and some of you may not have, but when the election was called, it really meant that we got a phone call saying that she was not able to speak in person, although she really wanted to. She loves Atlantic Canada and really wanted to be part of it. But we had a conversation with her office the other day, and they have great confidence that Claire Becker could actually do a wonderful job in sharing the messages that Dr. Tam would like to have shared. And I think that is because Claire, as scientific director of the National Collaborating Center on Determinants of Health, has been working with Dr. Tam and working with her messages for quite some time now, really familiar with her. And if you want to know more about Claire, her bio would be on HUVA. That wouldn't be hard to find. But I'm going to turn it over to Claire now with that introduction and have her provide some of the messages that we would have heard directly from Dr. Tam if we'd had the opportunity to do so. So Claire, I'll leave it with you. Take it away. Thank you.
Thanks, Patsy. I'm joining you today from Treaty One territory, the original land of the Anishinaabe, the Cree, the Oji Cree, the Dakota and the Dene people, and the homeland of the Métis Nation, also known today as Winnipeg, Manitoba. The NCCDH, the National Collaborating Center for Determinants of Health, of which I am have the distinct privilege of being the scientific director, is located in Mi'kma'ki, which, as you've heard, is the unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq people. And the center is hosted by St. Francis Xavier University in Antigonish, Nova Scotia. And thanks for the opportunity to be here today. Just a little bit about us, as Patsy mentioned, in our collaboration with Dr. Theresa Tam, the Chief Public Health Officer for Canada. The NCCDH is one of six national collaborating centers for public health located across Canada, which are funded by the Public Health Agency of Canada. And our role within the public health system is to advance structural and social determinants of health and health equity through public health practice, research, education, and of course, policy. We were all established, the six of us, in the wake of SARS, which I think is interesting and relevant to today, about 15 years ago. And we support public health practitioners, decision makers, policymakers, researchers, and educators through a variety of different knowledge translation methods. And so we're very excited to be here today with you to see the great agenda that Patsy and her crew, Malcolm and their crew have put together. So being involved is a really great opportunity for us, and we really look forward to networking with you and learning together. Congratulations, Patsy and Malcolm, the board and the planning committee for the stellar program that we put together. So I was asked to introduce Canada's Chief Public Health Officer, Dr. Theresa Tam, and then she was going to set the context for this conference. And as Patsy said, she's not able to be here today. So I'm going to try to provide a bit of context. And I'm going to start with just a little bit of history. Dr. Theresa Tam was named Canada's Chief Public Health Officer on June 26, 2017. And I'm sure she did not anticipate the role that she would end up playing now, back over the last 18 to 24 months, and steadily into the future. She's a physician with expertise in immunization, infectious disease, emergency preparedness, and global health security. And you've seen her in action, I know. So as Canada's public health, Chief Public Health Officer, Dr. Tam is the federal government's lead health professional for public health. And in this role, she provides advice to the Minister of Health. She supports and provides advice to the President of the Public Health Agency of Canada. And she works in collaboration with the President in the leadership and management of the Public Health Agency of Canada. The Public Health Agency of Canada Act empowers the Chief Public Health Officer to communicate across levels of government with voluntary organizations, as many of you, civil society, are represented here today, the private sector, and Canadians, the public, on all public health issues. And as part of that responsibility, the Chief Public Health Officer is required every year to support to provide a report to the Minister of Health on the state of public health in Canada. And that report under the legislation is due to the Minister of Health 6 months after the end of the fiscal year. So approximately every October. So last October, the Chief Public Health Officer tabled, Dr. Teresa Tam tabled her report, and she called it From Risk to Resilience, an Equity Approach to COVID-19. And I think that's a topic that's very relevant to today's conference and to the great reconnect that you're talking about. Dr. Teresa Tam, my observation is, takes the opportunity or the platform of that annual report very seriously. And those reports are extraordinarily informative. Now, resilience is a word that we've heard already tonight many times, and we hear it often, especially recently. And while it's a complex concept, I think, it really is about being able to recover after experiencing difficulty. And it requires several things. It requires time, it requires strength, and it requires help or support and collaboration with people and those around you. In the 2020 report, Risk to Resilience, it had several goals, one of which was to stimulate dialogue about issues that are critical to the health of the people in Canada as we responded to and we continue to respond to. But I think most importantly, as we recover and as we move into recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic. The report has many examples and opportunities for collaborative action. It highlights those. Dr. Teresa Tam is very clear that her bottom line is that no one is protected until everyone is protected. And she means and talks about protection in a very large and broad scope. The report has three sections to it. The first one really talks about the virus, COVID-19 virus, and its impacts from January to August of 2020. And that next report is due in October of 2021, and it'll bring us to present times. The second section looks at the health and social inequities in Canada and how they have been not only exacerbated, but how very, very harsh and strong light has been shed on those inequities that we knew existed, but also have been really heightened and exacerbated by the virus, but also by the public health measures that were put in place in response to the pandemic. And the report in particular highlights the inequities experienced by several populations, by women, by racialized populations, by those that have been called on to continue to provide essential services, those living with disabilities, and of course, seniors. But it's the third section that I want to just say a few things about, and that's the final section, really suggests, and as I said, that platform of the report suggests that we're in a watershed moment, and it advocates very strongly and very clearly for the use of a health equity approach as a way forward, and we've already heard those words as well. And they have three, she has three pillars in that, and I think they're relevant to your conversations over the next few days, and I think also very relevant as we look forward to Paul Bourne and his keynote, which will follow these comments. First is a strengthened public health capacity. Public health is the science and action of promoting health, preventing disease, and prolonging life, and we need a strong public health system. And that includes data systems, information systems, but also a sufficient and competent workforce with the capacity to surge and respond and support recovery into the future. And all levels of the public health system need to be strong for success in the future. And that includes working in really close alignment and engagement and collaboration with communities. Second pillar is leadership and governance at all levels for structural change. And the key there is at all levels, leadership at all levels, shared leadership at all those levels. And the participation, engagement of community members, policymakers, community organizations, social service organizations, as well as business leaders and other partners is absolutely essential to that shared leadership. And finally, and this I think has tremendous resonance, if you will, to what you're going to be talking about over the next 2 days. And that is the third pillar is harness the power of social cohesion. And social cohesion is the foundation of a resilient society. and the capacity of our communities to respond to COVID-19, to that crisis, has been absolutely remarkable. And there are many, many lessons that have been learned. And in the next few days, I know you will hear and contribute your ideas to the dialogue. And there are many, many opportunities for individual and collective action on that way forward. So from that report, and to set some context here today, the essential ingredients to taking an equity approach are capacity, both our systems, our people, our data and information. Second, strong leadership at every level. And third, social cohesion, which really in my mind means strong and engaged communities. So thank you for the opportunity. I wish for you a great conference, and thanks for the opportunity. Thanks, Patsy.
Thank you. I had a little struggle there with my mouth wanting to do what it should do. You did a great job, and I'm sure that she would feel really good if she could be sitting back and listening to you, Claire. So everyone, I know you were counting on having Dr. Tam here, but I think Claire did a great job for her, and you'd understand the circumstance for sure. So now I'd like to introduce Malcolm and ask him if he would take it from here and introduce our keynote, and we'll move on with the conversation with Paul Bourne.
Thank you, Patsy. I am very happy to introduce this keynote session this evening, featuring two fabulously creative people and leaders, Canadian leaders who have really contributed globally. This is a conversation interview with Paul Bourne, the co-CEO of the Tamarack Institute, based in Waterloo, Ontario. And he's being interviewed by Dr. Trevor Hancock, who is a professor and senior scholar retired at the School of Public Health and Social Policy at the University of Victoria. And Trevor is also really the father of the healthy communities movement in Canada and worldwide. So you can read their bios, which are impressive and extensive, by looking at their profiles in this session on HUVA. And I'm going to now ask Chantel to start the, before you start, let me just say that if you have questions as you go along and listen to the interview, please use the Q&A tab on the right-hand side of the HUVA screen to submit your questions. And what we'll be doing is forwarding those questions. Paul's not with us right now. He's somewhere where he's off the grid. Otherwise, he'd be joining us live. So we'll forward the questions to Paul, and then we'll get his responses and post them on the HUVA site. So Chantel, over to you and the video.
So I'm Trevor Hancock, and it's my pleasure to interview, or probably interview is the wrong word, have a conversation with my friend Paul Bourne. And Paul and I go back a long way. I first met him when I was part of a panel judging the Trillium Foundation's Healthy Community Awards back in the 90s. And he was working for the community, or was running the Community Opportunities Development Association in Waterloo. And we gave them the prize that year, the award for healthy communities. And then he went on and founded the Tamarack Institute, which is a wonderful organization that does great work on both community capacity building and trying to address and reduce poverty across the country. And Paul, I'm not going to try and fill in all the blanks there. I'm going to leave it to you to add whatever you want to that.
Yeah, lovely. You know, it's wonderful to be here at the Atlantic Summer Institute, and especially lovely to be interviewed by you, Trevor. You've always been one of my heroes. I've learned so much from you. And I guess the last project we did together is the video that you're actually showing at the conference, The Great Disconnect by Tamer Solomon, which he did just an amazing job. It was so inspiring to work on that project together. And looking forward to chatting with you today and hoping we could be of use to the learners, to the listeners here.
Well, thank you, Paul. And we'll have to avoid this becoming too much of a mutual admiration society.
Let's not do that part.
So the purpose of this opening session for the conference is to explore some of the issues around the importance of connection. We've called the conference The Great Reconnect, and it's about how do we reconnect not only as individuals and as families, but how do we reconnect with our community? How do we reconnect with the place we live? How do we reconnect with nature? And what does all that have to do with the health and well-being of infants and children and youth, particularly their mental well-being? Yeah. And so, Paul, you've been working for decades on deepening community. And so what does community connection mean for you?
Well, you know, it's my definition of community is people caring and being cared for. And when caring and being cared for happens often, that's when people feel the deepest sense of community. So there, and I think, you know, what's happened during COVID is we've somehow made community unessential. And I think, you know, as you would say, but that kind of made us realize that it was essential. And it's interesting because when we start thinking about children and youth and families, and we think about the role that community plays in their everyday life, things that we take for granted, going to school, right? And that was disrupted for many young people. Or when you went to school, it was fearful in some ways. It was but then that magic happens. Outside the school, you meet other parents, right? Or your neighbors, and you're not allowed to go and visit them. And when you do, they're at least 6 feet away. You're wearing masks a lot. So there is this kind of happening in which community itself seems, well, we can set that aside for now because it's not safe, right? It's not safe to gather. It's not safe to have people in for dinner. It's not safe to go to hockey practice. It's not safe to go to choir practice. It's not safe, right? And so what is that doing to young people? How are they beginning, you know, and it's like, they so desperately want to play with their friends. They so desperately want to go and talk to grandma and grandpa. They so desperately want to be with their teachers, with their hockey team, with their choir. You know what I mean? And so there's this unnaturalness that occurs. And I marvel, just simply marvel at the resilience of people. And there were times when I would just tear up, right? Where families learned different ways of connecting. You know, there's a neighborhood near us and lots of young children there, and they would play games, and the games would be in their windows, right? So they would play a bingo, but the numbers or the pictures were in the window. And so the children would run around the neighborhood with their parents, finding all of these bingos. And then the other children being, you know, the parents of those children would be in the windows kind of making faces or having fun, right? And they found ways to be community. You know, the fact that people would, I know at the beginning we were so worried that even if we touched something, it could have COVID on it. But eventually we said, forget that. And we just started bringing food to each other again, you know, bringing a bottle of wine to the parents who desperately needed it, you know, whatever it was. But we started to figure it out. I know that my own family, with my children, we've tried every kind of way of social distancing. You know, I remember we even had Christmas in the garage with both garage doors open, and our 91-year-old grandmother was there with us, you know, and we were like 10 or 15 feet apart because we all had masks on, took them off to eat turkey. That's it. Right. So it was like we figured all this out, and then we got a little fireplace in our backyard. And so it was, you know, minus 20 and we're sitting around this fire pretending we were getting warm, but we weren't, because we needed to talk and to connect. And I remember once my son, he's now in his early 20s. He said, Dad, and he got up and he walked and got his mask. It was in his backpack a little ways away, and he put it on and he said, I can't take it anymore. And he reached out his arms. He reached out his arms. And he said, I need a hug. It's the most beautiful moment. And he did that to me and to his mom. And, you know, of course, on CBC, we were taught how to hug already then. Take a breath, move your head to the side. He moved it to the other side and we hugged. And it was such a spiritual moment. And I just, you know, when I think about that, Trevor, I just say, wow, what happened? What happened? How did we get through all this?
Well, I think that there's a couple of things in there that I find very revealing. One is, as you say, the resilience. The other thing is, I think in an odd way, one of the benefits of COVID is it has helped to make us recollect that we need to connect. That to some extent in our busy world, a lot of that stuff tended to get pushed to the side. And suddenly we've realized, or gradually perhaps we've realized, no, actually, this is really important. And we really need to remember that. But there's another thing that I think I talk about the great COVID reveal. And I think one of the things that it revealed to us is that community and connection matters. But I think another thing that is very relevant to our conversation, and certainly very relevant to your work, is we suddenly realized that a whole bunch of people who had what the Brits call shit work, that were in fact the essential workers in our communities, yeah, and that they were being undervalued and underpaid and given all this lousy working conditions. And I wonder if you've seen that sort of thing too, because it seems to me there is perhaps a greater awareness. There's beginning to be, for example, a discussion about the idea of a guaranteed annual income or something like that, right, that people need to have not just a basic income, but a living wage. And that these workers that we thought of as completely unimportant were actually essential and core to our lives. They put the food on our shelves, they kept the buses running, they did all of those sorts of things.
Well, you know, Trevor, first of all, I think my wife would say the same thing about you than she says about me. She, you know, because when you think about the benefit or the thing that COVID gave us, I'm just thinking to myself, she says, folks, this is Paul. You know, the people who see the cup half empty and those who see it half full, well, he mostly sees it overflowing, and that just pisses me off most of the time. So here you are, this kind of a massive optimist, like, we just went through this crap, right? And here you're telling us we benefited in some way. But you're right, you know, you're right. And lest we forget, you know, how quickly things will, Brenda Zimmerman would always talk about, she was a great systems thinker, and she would always talk about snapback, like we snap back, like we move forward and then we snap back. And there's a sense of an enlightenment. And that enlightenment is very interesting, huh? You know, I keep saying to parents, the value of community for your children, right? Like, deepen community. Find the experience of community. And my sense is that when we miss it, an awareness arises. And in my book, Deepening Community, Finding Joy Together in Chaotic Times, I talk about those four principles of deepening your experience of community. Number one, get to know each other's story. Talk to each other, right? You never fear the person whose story you know, right? Number two, have fun together. Because fun has this way of bonding us in an incredible way. And you know, this is after interviewing 500 people. This is what they basically told me. Number three, learn to take care of each other. Find different ways of caring. And then number four, work together to make something better that's greater than yourself. And those were the four things that we really came to understand as the experiences of deepening community. And when I look at COVID, you know, this sense where we wanted to talk, and even if it had to be on this stupid Zoom, right? And just like 10 a day, right? But you know, we started, our friends started meeting with us on Zoom. You know, on Saturday, we're starting even another new group on Zoom called Cocktail Saturdays. And someone sends out a cocktail recipe and then we all follow it and we drink it together and have a chat. I'm part of a Zoom movie club. I'm part of a Zoom book club, right? Like, that's who we are, right? And I'm sure kids and children, in a sense, did the same thing, and parents and families trying to support each other that way. You know, this notion of having fun together is the one that I'm most disappointed in. I mean, some cities did it well. Like, I think the city of Edmonton did a marvelous job with their river that runs through, and what they did with skating there. They did ice shows. Like, they didn't pretend that everybody had to stay home. Like, they felt that there were ways that, okay, we could stay home and still have fun together. Right. I keep joking about Zorb balls. I want to get Zorb balls that you climb inside and then you run around and play soccer, right? And it's completely safe. I don't know why we never did that during COVID, right? Or the fact that, you know, but and then that third area is learning to care for each other. That was interesting because I felt that was a mixed experience. On some levels, we wanted to care, and we did things like phone people, and I would reach out to all my neighbors, and I would bake and all that kind of stuff. But on the other hand, I was always scared to be in contact with people. Even in the first 6 months, I was scared to drop off anything at anybody's place because I didn't know if I was infecting it, right? Mm-hmm. So there was this kind of sense, and I just feel like the powers to be failed on this level. Because, you know, in a sense, when you're dealing with a complex problem, you have to think about it from the perspective of it being a technical problem. Okay, so what's the technical nature of this problem called COVID? Then you need to look at it from the political issue. Okay, as politically, what effect does this have, right? What does it do in terms of being able to govern properly, right, within the context of this thing and just keep people safe? But then the third level of dealing with complex social problems is to deal with them at a social level. How are people interacting and engaging? How do we ensure that people are healthy and safe, right? How do we get, you know, how do we get those things happening? And I just feel we fail miserably It's like we dealt with the first two. We dealt with governance, which is basically was stay home, do nothing, close everything down. It's the only way that we're going to be safe. And technically, we need to deal with this technically because people are dying. And I just think, you know, wouldn't it have been wonderful if we were prepared and all of our neighborhoods had block captains? If we would hire artists who clearly understood how to do it safely, and they would go door to door, knock on the door, then go walk back 20 feet and sing us some songs, right? Or leave us some art or anything, right? Like if we just would have thought that through. I think the way that we sent children back to school it felt archaic to me. I'm sure there are better places in Canada than others, but it just felt like we sent them back and it was kind of like fend for yourself, we said to the teachers in some ways, right? Now, that's not everywhere, and I know that others had a plan, but it didn't feel that way all the time. And it just felt like at that social level, we are so smart. Nobody ever asked me, you know, and I write books on this. We have a 8,000 person learning community on deepening community. And nobody ever asked me, how do you think we could safely engage and interact together? Where were the think tanks? Where were the sense of needing to deal with the social consequences? And then what happened? People started rebelling. They said, forget this, and they visited unsafely. They played together unsafely, right? And so we made things worse by not dealing with the social consequences and kind of seeing COVID as a technical problem and maybe a political problem, a governance problem. And if we force people to do this, they will be safe. And I'm convinced that if we would have dealt with this at a social level, like some other countries did, we would have less mental health problems. People would have been safer. There would have been less backlash. And we got to think of that next time. Just like we have scientists spending all this money on a technical solution, we need to focus our energy and our money on a social solution during difficult times.
So let's take that notion of the social solution and take it out of difficult times and take it into, if you like, normal times, whatever normal turns out to be.
Right, the new normal times.
The new normal times. But what are the social solutions we need that some of which we've learned from this COVID experience, that we can apply going forward to create communities that are better for children than the communities we've had in the past? Not that they have been all that bad necessarily, but again, there's a whole equity issue that comes into this as well. So how do we do that in a way that is inclusive? So what are some of the things you think we might either learn from COVID or learn from the think tanks, your 8,000 member learning circle, about how we better build community from now on,
yeah,
or particularly for young people?
Well, there's a number of things. So I hadn't thought of CODA in 20 years. What Tamarack specializes in is large-scale community change. And to do that, we use a lot of innovative community engagement and collective impact approaches. And what we advocate is that we develop a common agenda, or some people call it a community plan. And so we have 30 cities now that are committed and who are currently developing plans to deepen the experience of community for people. And, you know, we talk about physical space. We talk about human connection. We talk about community safety. We talk about better neighborhoods. We talk about the citizen role in disaster preparedness. We talk about social capital. So these are the kinds of things that we're saying, okay, what's the current state of community in our city? And what is the desired state of community? And we look at sometimes the basic conditions, such as how many people are volunteering, how many people are voting. Like, those are the simple things. But then we also say, how engaged are our neighborhoods, right? How active are people in our neighborhood associations? How many people are coming to our festivals? I love to talk about the state of marriages. And are they small gatherings or large gatherings? I look at, the role of ritual in faith communities. You know, are they well attended? So we look for all kinds of things like that, right? We look at, food banks, and not just the people who are getting food, but the people who are giving food. So we look at that whole dynamic that's happening in a community. And then we ask the question, how do we get more of what is good and less of what is not? So how do we help children experience community? Well, simple ideas are coming up, but they're brilliant, right? So how do we teach all the coaches of the sports teams about the value of sport as community? We do the same with the dance troops and the choral troupes and the bands and all the other, so we try to get all, and they're almost all volunteers. So we're really preaching to the choir in all of those circumstances, and they're engaged, and they're going, oh, that's interesting. So little techniques, about having like a parent huddle with the kids just before the game, and reminding them why we're here together, which is primarily to have fun, right? And to be thankful, and to have, and to maybe see if there's a parent that would run a family, a community part, like a party for the team, right? There's this whole area of neighborhoods. It's catching on fire across the country, where cities are investing in neighborhoods.
Yes.
And they've got neighborhood strategies and neighborhood plans. And when people are attached to their neighborhood, when children feel safe in their neighborhoods, when they know their neighbors, when their neighbors are kind to them, right? Like, because in some ways, we've created a bit of a society where, and rightfully so, our children need to be aware, and they need to know how to engage in or safely. But then, if they start to get, I remember we moved to a new neighborhood, and in one of our houses, there was a Muslim family, a very traditional Muslim family. And we had just gotten here, so we hadn't had time really to go around to the neighbors. And then my kids came home, like, this was just weeks after we moved there, with a story, a negative story about that family that they had picked up at school. And I said to them, that's it. And I went outside that day, and I organized a neighborhood party, right? And everybody came. And they got to know those neighbors, right? Who happened to be one of our favorite neighbors to this day, right? But imagine if we wouldn't, if our children wouldn't have known them, they would have feared them. And what would that have done? So it's this sense of, the engineering that we're talking about here is being deliberate. And to understanding that we truly can build a stronger sense of community. And I think that's exciting. What if we put up, if we develop a common agenda? A common agenda is often done by just really engaging a lot of people and sort of running a campaign, almost coming up with a bunch of ideas, turning those into strategies, and then creating a 5-year plan that just helps us get better at community. And then schools start to adopt that kind of thinking as well, right? And it goes on and on. But I think that's, to me, the most hopeful work that we're doing right now, is this sense of making community and the betterment of community a deliberate activity.
And I think, to what extent would you say that is primarily going to have to happen at the municipal level, and to what extent do federal and provincial governments play a role in that? I mean, you know, you almost, well, we sort of have it at the municipal level. You have departments of recreation, yeah, which could rename the Department of Fun. And maybe we should rename it the Department of Fun. I mean, I'm a Morris dancer. We go out and dance in public, but basically we're there to dance for ourselves. Oh, and it's all about,
I've never seen that part of you. I wanna see that. That's on my bucket list now, Trevor.
but that's something, you know, that we organize spontaneously. But I think that the notion that, as you touched on earlier, that I think municipalities in particular are beginning to pay much more attention to neighborhoods, and you're beginning to see neighborhood development as a task. So it's no longer just about mains and drains and roads and so on, but it's about what my friend Len Dool used to call the soft infrastructure of community. So what is the role of federal, provincial, and municipal governments in that soft infrastructure?
Well, I think that's something that the ASI is going to talk about, and you should. I remember when we started Cities Reducing Poverty, our dream was that there might one day be a federal strategy and provincial strategy. And 20 years ago, they laughed at us when we said that. And today we have almost every province and the federal government with what I consider to be fairly aggressive poverty reduction strategies. And, you know, the minimum wage has moved its way up to almost $15 an hour across the country. I know Atlantic Canada is a little bit behind, but it'll catch up soon because everybody else is doing it. And BC's already jumped to $15.50, right? So, you know, just like in England, we have a minister of loneliness. I'm not sure that's what we need in Canada, but we clearly need to talk about mental health and the interconnection between community and mental health. The interconnection between, I know that you're also talking about nature at your gathering, and I mean, nature is just an interesting community in its own right, whether you think of it in a spiritual sense of being in a forest by yourself and being in the midst of this natural community that's all around you, or being in community with others in nature, right? Again, a beautiful aspect, but like, let's give credit to our government for doing a lot of things right. There is a very strong civil society in Canada. Many not-for-profit organizations. Many are caring deeply about their community and are working very deliberately to build a sense of well-being. Not everyone has that. Like, I'm working now in the country of Singapore, which is an incredibly advanced country, and, you know, probably has many social programs that are better than Canada. But they're struggling to have society be more engaged when they see a need of their neighbor, that they're able to reach out, right? I don't have that same sense here in Canada. I know that's under stress. So I think that the kind of the funding that's been happening, it's not funding that goes to an abyss, and we can be so cynical about that, But we have a pretty amazing infrastructure here that goes federal, provincial, municipal. And matter of fact, you know, in many places, the provinces have a bolder vision for community than the municipalities do. And it's quite a lovely thing to see. And I don't know, I guess, I mean, we can talk about what we want more, but I think what we need to do is put community at the center of how we currently deliver activities. And so when we do mental health work, do we focus primarily on one-on-one activities, or can we get better at group activities, right? Can we get better at finding a role for family in healing? Can we re-emphasize the importance of people being active in their community, right? And the importance of volunteering. Like, there's a lot of basic things that I think we've come to agree strengthen and support mental health. But the more clinical we focus things, and absolutely we have some amazing clinicians and we have amazing professionals, and I'm not taking a moment away from them, but sometimes it feels like that's all the money we have, because there's more of a proven science to it. And I think emphasizing the role that community plays in well-being and sense of community plays in mental health, sense of belonging plays in mental health, sense of purpose plays in mental health. Caring and being cared for. It's not just being cared for. You know, a friend of mine, his mother had gone into a nursing home, and I said, how is it? It's a brand new one. It seems lovely. He said, it's okay. And I said, what do you mean? What do you mean it's okay? It's like one of the best ones in town. And he said, you know, my mother was always happiest when she was caring for others. And they took that away from her. So I'm kind of saying, how do we build that back into the service system? And then that's the role of community, you know, and how do we build like nature back into our communities? And Canada, again, we've been really lucky, and most of Canada isn't paved over. And many of our school grounds are taking out parking lots and putting green back in and planting trees and having community gardens and going for walks, and to recognize the value of that in children. And I can't wait for the day when, you know, children will be in a classroom and you know, at 10 o'clock in the morning and 3 o'clock in the afternoon, everybody gets up and goes for a walk in the woods. You know, and that's not their recess time. That's part of their learning time. Right, that we do this because we understand the connection between well-being in nature and well-being in community, and that we learn faster and more intensely when we engage with each other and when we engage with nature.
And we'll leave it at that.
Trevor, again, an honor to be on camera with you, and thanks to Malcolm and the whole crew for their help and for all the good work that's happening in the community and through this conference. All the best, everyone.
Great. Thanks.
Thanks to Trevor and to Paul for a fascinating conversation. This isn't part of it for later, but just my personal thanks on behalf of ASI. Very much appreciated.
Thanks, Malcolm.
Wow, how about that? I sat through that interview conversation and listening to it again, I realized how rich and deep it truly is and how it resonates with so much about what we are going to be talking about over the next couple of days. What's being shown in our Atlantic Showcase, what we're going to be hearing about from speakers and panelists, what you're going to be talking about amongst yourselves. Just an amazing 30 minutes. Now, I want to thank Trevor for volunteering to do the interview. You know, you can see that he and Paul have known each other for a long time, so the rapport was obvious and relaxed. And so the give and take really enriched the conversation. And thanks to Paul for his immediate willingness to accept our invitation to participate, to share his wisdom, to share his thinking, to share his experience, to share his ideas about deepening community and all the ways that how important that is for our lives. So again, to remind you that if you have questions you'd like to pose to Paul, put them in the Q&A section on the right-hand side or in the tab you see Q&A under this session. We'll forward those questions to Paul and we'll post his responses. I also want to let you know that we have quite a number of the books, Deepening Community, that Paul referred to. And all the speakers will be receiving a copy as a thank you for their contribution to the Summer Institute. And for those of you who would like to purchase a copy, we have information somewhere on the website. Patsy can probably remind us about that later on. I also want to say that as is our tradition, we give to a keynote, a work of art, an original work of art. It's a print, but it's a print of an original work of art. Well, before I get into that, you know, there's one more thing I want to say about deepening community. Paul has offered to set up a post-conference dialogue for those who have a copy of his book, whether it's been given to you or you purchase it. And when he's back on the grid, we'll set up a Zoom call and he'll take us through the book and give some of the behind the scenes scoop about what they did to come up with their learnings for the book. Oh, here's my note to you. If you're interested in purchasing the book, we have a webpage with more details about it. So as a thank you to Paul, we're going to be providing to him a print of our signature art piece that was done by the PEI artist Maurice Bernard in, I think it was 2006. And Patsy has it on display. So I'm going to end my video. And Patsy, you can turn yours on and you can see the video. Say something so we see you. I guess I'm speaking. Anyway, there it is over her left shoulder. And it's a painting of children playing on a beach in Prince Edward Island. And they're all wearing hats. We wanted to make sure they were sun safe. This is back in 2006. Anyway, let's get a closer look at that. This is a numbered print, beautifully framed. I've got one hanging in my home. There's a lot of them out there and about that we've given out over the years. So we'll be sending that to Paul as a thank you for his contribution. Trevor already has one from the year when he was a keynote speaker. So having said all that, I'm going to turn it back over to Patsy for the closing.
Okay, and before I move into the closing, just to let you know, this is the book that speakers will be receiving. And there is an exhibit page that has more details on where, if you're interested, where you can purchase the book, a little bit more about the book, actually, and we'll keep everyone posted about the opportunity following ASI. So in closing, what I'd really like to say is I'm sure for me and for all of you, the evening has provided much to think about and reflect upon as we draw the evening to a close. I want to thank guests who have joined us live stream on YouTube. You're not here with us tomorrow, but hopefully you have lots to think about and you can chat with us, any one of us who are here, about more details. I also want to thank the people who have registered, who have been here. It's been a little bit over time, but while we can't stop now and have a glass of wine and reception, stroll through the exhibits, we can do as much as we can with that in Hoover. So that's one reason why we selected this forum, is that it allows us to actually engage in a number of different ways. And tomorrow at 10 o'clock in the morning, this is Atlantic time, we'll start with speed dating. So we bring your cup of coffee and you'll just come and you simply arrive and be randomly placed in a room with three other people for 10 minutes. And you get to talk a little bit and find out who's in the room and what you might share in common, what kind of questions you have, why you might be here. And then you'll be moved again to another room and you meet another three people. And it'll happen three times in half an hour, and then you'll have a break and then join the main session at 10:40. So you have a chance that way to chat face-to-face via Zoom and discover who's in the room. As well, we have a playlist of Atlantic Canadian music, and that'll be something that you'll have to discover as to where that is. We'll put some hints around. But if anyone is rather have some time on their own during a break, they just want to chill a little bit zoomed out, the music is there for you. You can just listen away. The other thing is that we're going to try to make it a little bit fun and build a bit of online community while we're here. So we're have a prize every day. The prize will be a book, and it'll be to really reward people who are fully engaged. So today we already have a prize, and it is to Samaya Mohammed for starting the icebreaker. She was the first one on, and she's the one that got it started. So I'm not sure if she's still with us or not. It's getting a little bit later. But if she is, to let me know, and you'll definitely have a book on the way. Claire sent me messages here, so I'm not exactly sure what that's about. The other thing I wanted to let you know is that tomorrow there's going to be a scavenger hunt, and the winner will get a prize for that too. So we'll announce that at the end of the day. So you're going to be able to find the scavenger hunt and questions, instructions by going to documents, but under the resources tab and look up scavenger hunt. So shouldn't be too difficult. Just navigate a little bit around, try the different labels that you can see and see, is there something in there that I should find out? But this one says to go to documents, and you should be able to get some instructions, and it'll have you looking for things all over the Hoover site. So you probably get to know about the site a little bit more and find out something that you didn't know about. So we're thinking here that, you know, have some fun connecting even when we can't connect in person. And for those who have not viewed the film The Great Disconnect yet, you still have time to do that till the end of the week. We have the license. We purchased the license for the film. It's to be used for forum registrants only. Unfortunately, I know there are some questions. Can we share it because it's so good? But we have that opportunity. So I'm sure if you sat down with somebody and that you knew that you wanted to see it and shared it with them, would be fine. But we just can't be promoting it outside the forum. And the last thing is, and how could I forget, because this was really special, on the very last day, which isn't too far away, there'll be a draw for a beautiful painting that's been donated by a Newfoundland artist whose name is Adam Young. And we will have some of his website and some of his work up on the exhibit page tomorrow. May not be there today. I'm not too sure. I haven't been down to look. I know we've had a lot on our plate today getting everybody registered. So chances are that there could be a, a little delay there, but it should be there tomorrow, and you get to see what the artwork is like. It's beautiful, and you'll hope that you're there to be part of the draw. So I guess, we're drawing to a close here. We have a full program. We're so pleased that we have such a lot of people registered. We thought we might do well to have 130 this year because we thought of all the Zoom fatigue, and we're well over that now. So we're very happy that we were able to attract the people that we have and the speakers that we have. And we're ready now for the great reconnect, working together to build that personal, community, and societal resilience for our post-COVID-19 world. So, keep your eye out for emails and notification from ASI staff over the next few days for messages. You'll get some instructions and some announcements. And if you want to engage with us and engage with other people, go right ahead. There's a community board there. If you've got some ideas of things you want to do over a break or projects you might like to connect with someone on, please do that. I mean, really what this is all about is coming together, seeing what we can do to build a better future for our children, our grandparents, our families, just generally a better world that will manage the crises that are ahead and the lives that we're engaged in now. So good night, everybody. And again, thank you. I don't think there's anything more that I have to say, and I'm open to any kind of questions or comments that anybody has. Anyone from the rears? Any staff want to say anything, or can we call it a night? Seems quiet. Okay, everyone. Thank you. We'll see you tomorrow.